Hello everyone. Today we are here to talk on SA 220, the auditing standard on quality control for audit of financial statements. With the current environment where auditors are being questioned by several regulators, this is one standard which assumes a significant amount of importance in today's environment. Quality control by itself presupposes that an audit firm has got to have quality into its every element of the audit process has to have quality. This standard basically hovers around how you are going to ensure quality, how you are going to control the quality when you audit a financial statements. With this background in mind, let us move forward on each of these aspects of the standard. Here, if you see on the slides, this is what the standard is going to cover. It covers the scope, it covers the quality control, it covers the objective. There are several definitions given in the standard. We'll be dwelling on each of the definitions given in the standard. There are certain requirements and responsibilities which are cast. We'll be dealing with those requirements and responsibilities. Independence is one of the key things of the standard. We'll be dwelling on that. There's acceptance and continuity of engagements, the engagement team that one uses for the audit, the engagement performance, which is the main body of the standard and what is supposed to be done during engagement performance. And the last few slides are on monitoring and documentation. For ease of reference, for each of the headings given in the auditing standard, I have given the relevant slide numbers. So these can be accessed according to the headings of the standard. With this, let's go to the first thing. What is the scope of the standard? The standard deals with the responsibilities of two people. It deals with the responsibilities of the auditor in respect of the quality control procedures for an audit of the financial statements, and it deals with the responsibilities of the engagement quality control reviewer. This is the responsibilities that are cast by the standard. This is the scope of the standard. And one needs to remember that this standard needs to be read in conjunction with the relevant ethical requirements prescribed by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India and the Code of Ethics. One more thing, as I said at the start, we need to assume that a firm has a set of quality controls in place. There is an entire SQC1 which deals on how audit firms need to have SQC processes in place, and this entire standard presupposes that an audit firm applies SQC1. So what does this quality control standard do? It casts a responsibility on the audit firm. What is the responsibility that it casts? It casts a responsibility that the audit firm has to implement a quality control system that provides a reasonable assurance. It's not an absolute assurance, it's not a moderate assurance. Like an audit opinion, on similar lines, it is a reasonable assurance that the firm and its personnel comply with the professional standards of the institute and are in compliance with legal and regulatory requirements. And the reports issued by the firm are appropriate in the circumstances. So this is the main crux of the standard. This is the main responsibility cast by the standard, that the audit firm has to implement a quality control system. The second responsibility is cast on the engagement team. And what is the responsibility cast on the engagement team? That they are responsible to implement the quality control procedures of the firm in each audit engagement that they do. And they also have a responsibility to provide the firm with the relevant information to enable functioning of the QC system as far as independence goes. So this standard under quality control has cast two responsibilities, one on the audit firm to implement the quality control system and on the engagement team to implement the quality control procedures to an audit engagement. Coming to slide number 5, the role of the engagement team is defined here. The engagement team can fairly assume or presuppose or rely on the firm's quality control system. So, as we said in the earlier slide, they are supposed to be following the quality control and implementing the quality control procedures, but they can also rely on the firm's quality control procedures unless there is some information which the engagement team has that suggests that they should not follow the firm's quality control systems. The standard has given certain examples or certain areas where a quality control can be presupposed by the engagement team. These areas are the competence of the individuals. So an engagement team member is entitled to assume or rely that the people around them are competent, that the people around them are independent to the audit engagement, that the firm has maintained client relationships through acceptance and continuum systems, and that the firm adheres to legal and regulatory requirements. Coming to the objective of the standard. What is the objective of the standard? This standard says that a firm is required to implement quality control procedures at each engagement level that provide a reasonable assurance for two things: that audit complies with the professional standards and legal requirements, and that the audit report that is issued is appropriate in the circumstances. This is the crux of the standard. This is the reason the standard has been developed, to basically have quality control procedures at each engagement level, providing a reasonable assurance that the audit complies with the standards and that the audit report issued is appropriate. This standard has got roughly 12 to 13 definitions, and we'll be taking each of those definitions one by one. The first definition is of an engagement partner. Engagement partner is a partner or any person or other person in the firm who necessarily has to be a member of the institute, has to be in full-time practice, and who is responsible for the engagement and the performance of this engagement. That person is also responsible for the report issued on behalf of the firm, and he has the appropriate regulatory approval authorities. We need to understand that under this standard, an engagement partner can be any other person of the firm also, need not be a partner of the firm. The next is engagement quality control review. This is a process which is designed to provide an objective evaluation before the report is issued for significant judgments and conclusions of the engagement team in formulating the report. So it is necessary to understand that this review has to be performed before the report is issued, and it is to evaluate whether the person has done the audit correctly or not in respect of forming conclusions and in respect of significant judgments which have been placed when the report has been formulated. The next definition is of the engagement quality control reviewer. On similar lines, it is a person or a partner or a suitably qualified external person or a team of such individuals. So a reviewer can be in four capacities. He or she can be a partner in the firm, any other person in the firm. It can be a suitably qualified external person as well, or it could be a team of such individuals. But what is necessary is that to have sufficient and appropriate experience and authority. They should be objectively be able to evaluate the significant judgments or the conclusion of the engagement team. The word here, important word one needs to note, is this is objective. So the evaluation has to be a completely unbiased and objective evaluation, and it has to be done before the report is issued. If the quality control reviewer is a team of such individuals, then the team necessarily has to be led by a person who is a member of the Institute of the Chartered Accountants of India. The engagement team, simple enough definition, all person forming the engagement, but the definition has been widened to include outside experts that are contracted by the firm for the engagement. So experts who are contracted by the firm are also covered under this standard as a part of the engagement team, and quality control procedures would apply to those outside experts as well. Firm does not necessarily mean a partnership firm. It can mean a sole practitioner. It can mean any other entity or professional accountants as may be permitted by law. Inspection. Inspection is done only in case of completed engagements, and it is a procedure designed to provide evidence of compliance with the firm's quality control policies and procedures. Listed entity, fairly simple, stocks or shares that quoted on a recognized stock exchange or traded. Monitoring is another important aspect of the standard, and monitoring says that it is an ongoing process of evaluating the firm's quality control system. So it is not a one-time process, it is not supposed to be paused at a point of time, it's an ongoing review of the firm's quality control system. It needs to be evaluated by including a periodic inspection of selected assignments. So earlier, the definition of engagement quality control review was it has to be done before the audit report. Monitoring is another aspect of the standard, and that needs to be done as an ongoing process. And it is one of the aspects to do it is doing a post-facto inspection of completed assignments. The objective is to obtain a reasonable assurance of the operating effectiveness of the quality control system working in the firm. Network firm is a firm or an entity that belongs to a network, and network is defined very nicely in the standard. It says it is a large structure and that large structure is aimed at either cooperation and profit or cost share. And what does it share? It has certain common things which they share. They share either ownership, either control, either management, either QC policies, either business strategies, brand name or professional resources. So network firms are basically firms that are part of the larger structure and they are so defined in the standard. Partner is any individual with the authority to bind the firm with respect to performance of its professional engagement. Personnel covers both partners and staff. Professional standards, engagement standards as defined in the auditing standards revised preface and the relevant ethical requirements. And the relevant ethical requirements are those prescribed by the institute in the code of ethics. Staff is professionals other than partners employed by the firm. So once again, a reading of all these definitions shows you that the objective of the standard is to cover all the people in any aspect that would be covered or be involved in the audit engagement. It could be people who are outside experts, people who are professionals other than partners, as well as the regular employees of the firm. Suitably qualified external person. Suitably qualified external person is one of the people in the definitions of engagement quality control reviewer, is a person who can conduct the review, an engagement quality control review. And that is also defined as an individual who has to be outside the firm with the capabilities and the competence to act as an engagement partner. It could be a partner, employee of another firm with appropriate experience. So let's come to what the standard requires us to do. So the standard originally cast a responsibility, as we saw in the earlier slides, on the audit firm. So now today we will be taking up the responsibilities of the engagement partner within the audit firm. Engagement partner is responsible for the overall quality of the audit engagement assigned to him or her. This is the underlying principle of the standard. The engagement partner has to take overall responsibility. And that responsibility has to be demonstrated by the engagement partner to the engagement team through his actions or her actions, or through messages or through communication from the engagement partner regarding the overall quality of the audit engagement. Now, what does this comprise of? The communication should reflect that the audit work that has to be done is in compliance with the professional standards and the legal and regulatory requirements. That the audit work or engagement done is in compliance with the firm's applicable quality control procedures. Once again, there is a presupposition in the standard that the firm has its own quality control policies and procedures in place. One of the best ways to do it is to have a complete SQC manual, which covers all the aspects recognized in SQC 1, and that would be the base under which the engagement team and the engagement partner would perform any audit engagement. The communication also has to demonstrate or reflect the audit quality in ensuring that the audit reports that are issued are appropriate under the circumstances. At the same time, the communication to the engagement team should also say, or the actions by the engagement partner should also reflect that the engagement team can raise their concerns without fear either to him, her, or to the management. As I said at the start of the slide, quality is essential. The standard itself presupposes that SQC, that is standard on quality control. So quality is essential and indispensable in an engagement performance. What is the engagement partner supposed to do? He or she is supposed to remain alert. How? Through inquiry and observation. For what? For evidence or to understand whether there is any non-compliance by the engagement team with respect to the ethical requirements of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. So the engagement partner not only has to be responsible, he also has to remain alert through inquiry and observation for evidence of non-compliance by the engagement team to the relevant ethical requirements of the Institute. What are the relevant ethical requirements of the Institute with respect to the standard? First and foremost is the integrity of the person who is doing the audit. Objectivity is paramount. A person cannot be auditing an engagement or be involved in an assignment where there is a subjective interest. So objectivity is paramount. Professional competence and due care. Client confidentiality, data confidentiality is a big thing today. Clients anyway very particular, so it is also one of the ethical requirements of the Institute of Confidentiality, and the behavior of the profession. And through this inquiry and observations, if it is observed that any non-compliance has actually happened, or even if there is an indication of a non-compliance, the engagement partner has to either consult others in the firm or determine what is the action to be taken on the specific member of the engagement team with respect to such non-compliances with the ethical requirements of the institute. The engagement partner is supposed to form a conclusion on the compliance with applicable independence requirements. Independence is one of the basis of the standard. Alright, and independence would necessarily mean that there is no other pecuniary relationship or any other business material dealing of any of the engagement partner or the engagement team with respect to the client. So how does the engagement partner go about doing this? The engagement partner obtains the relevant information from the firm or from the network firm. He or she identifies and evaluates whether those information or those circumstances and relationship threaten the independence of the assignment. If, based on that information, if there is a threat, he determines if there is a threat, and then either he or she has to take appropriate action or say that they are unable to take appropriate action and report back to the firm. If they have to take action, the action that they need to take is to eliminate the threats. So the first action he would say is for if there is an issue and there is a information that has threatened independence, either the threat has to be eliminated. How can the threat be eliminated? Either by if there is a particular engagement team member whose independence is threatened, that engagement team member may not be involved in the assignment. Or reduce the threats to an acceptable level. So if, for example, there are business dealings of an engagement team member with a client, you may take a call that no, up to 5,000 rupees or up to 2,000 rupees or up to a certain level, those threats are not going to threaten independence and they are an acceptable level. So one may continue with that, or one may take a commitment that no further business dealings or no other dealings will happen with that firm. Or if it is so serious, then you may withdraw from the assignment if permitted by law. This is basically the entire structure on independence and forming a conclusion. The next part of the standard talks about accepting or continuing an engagement. So the engagement partner is supposed to do two things. He is supposed to be satisfied that necessary and appropriate procedures have been followed when it comes to accepting or renewing the assignment for a client. And he has to determine whether the conclusions reached in this regard are appropriate. Now, if he obtains information today that would have changed the decision of the firm to accept the assignment at the time they took it, he or she is supposed to communicate that information promptly to the firm, and the firm has to take a decision as to whether they would like to continue with the assignment or withdraw from the assignment. So acceptance and continuity of engagements is one of the important aspects of the standard, and the engagement partner is supposed to be satisfied or to determine. How does the engagement partner determine that necessary procedures have to be followed, or what are the factors one would consider to say whether one should continue to accept or continue the assignment? So the standard has given certain indicators. This is not an exhaustive list, but only indicators. The most important one being the integrity of the owners, of the key management personnel, and to those charged with governance. So this needs to be evaluated at the time of accepting continuing an assignment. Whether the owners of the company, the key management, those charged with governance have the necessary integrity, or they are known criminals or blacklisted willful defaulters. So this is the kind of thing one needs to keep in mind. The competence and the capabilities of the engagement team, including time and resources. Many of us fall into this trap as practitioners where we may not have the time or the qualified resources, but just end up taking up the audit assignment because of commercial considerations. So this is one of the things the standard tells you to do, is ensure that you have competent and capable people to conduct the assignment, including the timely availability of those people and the necessary qualified resources. And compliance with the ethical requirements by the engagement team. The last thing one would need to consider is significant matters that have arisen during the current or the previous audit. So if there is any indication of a previous auditor resigning, or if there is any indication of your previous audit assignments that necessary information was not provided, or there was some other significant matter which would threaten your independence or the independence or the reason to continue this assignment, it is one of the other factors one should consider. Thank you.